Welcome to this lesson on identity-based policies and resource-based policies. So we're going to do a bit of a deep dive on these two aspects of IAM. We'll start with identity-based policies. Now, for both types of policy, they're written in JavaScript object notation, so the JSON language. And these are permissions policies. That means they're there to control what actions an identity can perform. Now, actions in the case of AWS essentially means API calls. Once we've authenticated to AWS, then we need to be authorized to make API calls. Those are the actions. So the actions essentially are the individual API calls that an identity is going to be permitted to actually make. Now they're attached to IAM identities. So that's users, groups, and roles. So as you know, we have users, groups, and roles. We can apply the permissions policies directly to each of these elements within IAM. So if we have some specific settings to apply to a user, we can attach a permissions policy directly to the user. Otherwise, if it's the same set of permissions that we need for other users in a particular department or part of the business, we can put those users in a group and apply the permissions policy there instead. Also, we have roles. These are used for assuming a different identity temporarily and also used for delegation to services as well. So they can actually take on some permissions for making API calls to other services. Now, the identity-based policies can be customer managed, which basically means you manage it, you create it, you write the policy, you manage the policy, or AWS managed. If they're AWS managed, then they already exist in your account. So when you first create your AWS account, you can go straight into IAM, go to the policies section, and you'll find that there's already a lot of AWS managed policies in there. So those are good for common job roles or common use cases. They've created a policy which is, you know, it has a certain set of permissions for a particular use case, such as a billing admin, for example, or an administrator. But you might want to customize that and refine it a bit more. Now we can also attach policies inline as well. So what does that mean? Well, when we apply an inline policy, it's attached directly to the user, the group, or the role, and actually managed independently. So it's not a permissions policy that exists in IAM within the policies section. So within IAM, you can click on policies and you can actually see the permissions policies there, the customer managed and the AWS managed. You will not see the inline policies there. They're actually created within the user group or role and attached to it. So essentially, you go into the configuration for the user if you're doing it through the console, and then you can create an inline policy. It only exists within that user account. You can't find it anywhere else. You can't reuse it later on by attaching it to another user because it doesn't exist independently of that user account. So there's a one-to-one relationship. If you delete the identity, so the user or the group or the role, then the policy goes with it. Next, we have resource-based policies. These are also JSON policy documents, and you attach them to a resource such as an Amazon S3 bucket. So here we have an S3 bucket. It has a resource-based policy attached. Now, you'll note something in this resource-based policy. There is this element here, which is the principal element. You will never see the principal element in an identity-based policy. So as soon as you see this, you know that it's a resource-based policy. Why is that? Well, there's no need to specify the principal this applies to when it's the actual policy is attached to an identity. The identity is the principal. So when you see that, you know it's a resource-based policy. Now, in this case, it's attached directly to a bucket, and this policy grants Paul the permission to perform specific actions on the resource. So the principal being Paul, this is the ARN for Paul's user account, and Paul is allowed to make any S3 API calls on the resource, which is the bucket. So that's a bucket within this account. So that's an example of a resource-based policy. So resource-based policies are attached directly to AWS resources, and they define who can access the resource and what actions they can perform. Not all services support resource-based policies. Some examples of services that do support resource-based policies are Amazon S3, we just saw an example, that's called a bucket policy. AWS Lambda has resource-based policies, so for example, allowing the invocation of a function. For example, if you create an API and connect the API through to a Lambda function, it actually automatically creates a resource-based policy, allowing that particular API to call the function, to invoke the function. Then we've got SNS with topic policies. We've got SQS with queue policies. We've got DynamoDB, which allows you to apply access permissions to tables, indexes, and streams for very granular control, and KMS with key policies as well. Resource-based policies are very useful for cross-account access, and that's because they let users or roles from another account access a resource directly. You can specify exactly who, so which IAM users, roles, or accounts have access to a resource, and then, of course, what actions they can perform. And there's no need to create and manage IAM roles in every account. You can just define the permissions at the resource level. For example, if you own this account, it's just a fake account ID, of course, all ones to make things easy, and you have an S3 bucket called My Cross Account Bucket, and you want to allow users from AWS account all twos to read objects from this bucket. In that case, you would use a permissions policy like this one. This policy allows all IAM users and roles in the account with all twos in the account ID to read objects from My Cross Account Bucket directly. So you can see we have an allow. The principle is ARN AWS IAM, the account ID, and then root. It doesn't mean the root account specifically. It actually means all accounts within that particular AWS account. And they're going to be allowed S3 get objects on the objects within this particular bucket. Another example of a resource-based policy is when we have an IAM role. Now, as you know, with roles, we have to define a trust policy, and that defines who is allowed to assume the role. Okay, that's an example of a resource-based policy. In this case, this trust policy will allow any IAM user or role in the account to assume the role. And then we have a permissions policy, and of course that's an identity-based policy. So when we're creating IAM roles, we actually have the trust policy, which is resource-based, and then the identity-based policy, which is the permissions policy defining what actions the entity that's allowed to assume the role is able to then perform, what API calls can they make within the account. This particular permissions policy allows the identity to start instances in any AWS region. Let's finally compare these two side by side, identity-based policies versus resource-based policies. So with identity-based policies, they're attached to IAM users, groups, and roles. Resource-based policies are applied directly to the AWS resource, and not all resources will support a resource-based policy, so some services do not. The permissions will apply to the IAM identities that the identity-based policy is attached to, and for the resource-based policy, it's applied directly to the resource itself. The only way you can do cross-account access with an identity-based policy is by assuming a role, whereas with resource-based policies, you can directly grant cross-account access. In terms of the resources you can apply permissions to, with identity-based policies, it's really any API call, so any service, and in some cases via assuming a role. So let's summarize identity-based versus resource-based policies. So if identity-based, they are applied to users, groups, and roles. Resource-based policies are applied directly to the resources, that is, in many cases, the AWS service, and not all services do support resource-based policies. Now, in both cases, they define the actions that can be performed. In the case of an identity-based policy, it's assigned to the identity, so the permission will be granted to the identity that the policy is actually applied to. In terms of a resource-based policy, it can be everyone or it can be a specified principal. For cross-account access, with identity-based policies, you must assume a role, so you can't really do it directly, whereas with resource-based policies, you can. Now, the best practice is to use identity-based policies for granting permissions within an account and resource-based policies for external access, like cross-account sharing. Some services do support both, like S3 and Lambda, for more granular control as well.